Some say good morning, some say God bless, some say possibly, some say yes.
Tonight on Emerald City, actor Ken Kliban talks with theater golden boy Marshall Mason. Also coming up from Tramps, a look at the song style of singer-composer David Spangler.
Some complain of strain and stress.
Hello. We're happy to have as our guest on Emerald City this evening perhaps one of the most accomplished off-Broadway directors in the very history of that term. To list his achievements would take me well into the middle of this program, so I'll spare you, but I will tell you he's the only director that Lanford Wilson really trusts. Tonight, actor Ken Kliban will be talking with Mr. Marshall Mason of Circle Repertory fame, or legend. Mr. Mason's latest triumph is entitled The 5th of July, and the reviews have been consistently terrific. We're not able to show you any clips from this one because of the equity laws, but I suggest that you check it out yourself. Also, a little later in this evening's program, we'll take a look at David Spangler, who was a very impressive performer. We recorded him at Tramps on Manhattan's East Side. David has only recently made his debut as a performer, even though he's been a major writer and composer for a number of years. He's talented and good-looking, and I'm sure you're going to be hearing a lot of him in the future. He performed one particular love song that I really got off on called Jonathan, and we'll be showing you a bit of that a little later. So we'll pause for a word from our sponsors and continue from the Emerald City after this. Don't go away.
Come to Man's Country. See what we're all about and what we have to offer. Man's Country is a full facility, multi-leveled complex that was designed to feature something for everyone. Come to Man's Country and develop your body or a friendship with somebody else's. Visit us once and you'll come again and again. For the best workout in town, it's Man's Country, 28 West 15th Street.
The Manhattan Community Athletic Association is holding a one-to-one benefit softball game. The Christopher Street Crusaders from the Gay Softball League versus the City Police Championship team of the last 2 years, the 6th Precinct. The date is Sunday, June 11th at 3 p.m. The game will be held at Central Park Diamond No. 1 at 61st Street and Central Park West. The after-game party will be held at Hurrah, and there is a donation of $1. Again, the date is Sunday, June 11th at 3 p.m., Central Park Diamond No. 1 at 61st Street and Central Park West. Come on out. You may find it difficult locating Jan Wallmans, but the best things in life aren't always easy to find. Jan Wallmans, 28 Cornelia Street, where 6th Avenue meets West 4th. Jan Wallmans, fine food in a fine setting.
Good evening. Welcome to Emerald City. My name is Ken Kliban. We're very pleased to have with us this evening Mr. Marshall Mason, the artistic director of the Circle Repertory Company. Marshall, good evening. I won't spend too much time going over the incredible list of awards that you've received in the theater because that would take up our entire time. I will just mention that Marshall has directed over 20 of Lanford Wilson's plays. He is the winner of 5 Obie Awards for Distinguished Direction, Joseph Jefferson Award, Vernon Rice Award, the Margot Jones Award, and under his direction and leadership, the Circle Repertory Company has produced such marvelous plays as The Hotel Baltimore, When You Come Back, Red Rider, The Seahorse, Jules Pfeiffer's Knock Knock, Gemini, which I believe is still playing on Broadway after celebrating its first birthday, David Story's The Farm, Tennessee Williams' The Battle of Angels, and so on. The Circle Repertory has received 3 Tony Award nominations, 22 Obie Awards, 8 Drama Desk Awards, 4 Theater World Awards, and so on. That's it for the awards. Now,
that didn't take the whole program.
Now I will let you speak. and tell us, in all modesty, how can a kid come from Amarillo, Texas, to New York at the age of 21, I believe, and after a mere 10 or 20 years of hard work in the theater, achieve the kind of commercial and artistic success that you have? I would assume that many kids come to New York striving to be directors with talent and don't make it. What do you think you had? What qualities did you have that allowed you to reach this point?
Persistence, I think. I don't know. I once heard a story about Ruth Gordon. Somebody asked her what her secret of success was, and she said, "You hang in there longer than anybody else," and that's what really does it. It's not really very much of a Cinderella story, though, because I think it is very dedicated, hard work, and it's really holding on to your ideals.
You mentioned that your favorite playwrights are Chekhov, Tennessee Williams, Lanford Wilson. What do they have in common?
There's a phrase which I've had used in connection with our work called lyrical realism. That somebody else made that up. It's not my word, but I think in a way it does describe. I'm very fascinated, apart from the human being aspect of it. The other thing that really interests me is the musical nature of the theater experience. When you have an ensemble of people playing together, it's very much like a string quartet or a small orchestra, depending on the size of the cast. But and there is a rhythm and a mood which the people can create together, which is quite musical in effect. I think the Hotel Baltimore, for instance, was very clear in that regard. There were even moments that seemed to be actual duets or trios, and there were other moments that were really solos, and then there were moments where everyone was talking all at the same time, as you would have in an orchestral piece.
You've had a very special relationship with the works, particularly of Lanford Wilson.
Yes.
You probably are more familiar with the themes and the style of his work than anyone else. Tell us a little about what particularly attracts you to his type of playwriting.
Well, I think it's what I was just saying about music. Also, Lanford has a wonderful humanism about his work. He's extremely interested in dreams, in the American myths, the fabric of American lives, and the way in which our internal reality, I think, sometimes is in harsh disagreement with the external realities. And he is interested in the human being and in the music of the American experience in a very unusual way. And I think that examination of where are we now at this moment is the same thing that I admire in Chekhov. You take the Three Sisters, for instance, in which I think Chekhov wrote the play in 1905, and just at that moment in history, Russian government was on the verge of revolution, and within a few years that revolution was accomplished. And Chekhov's just examining people's lives was able to pick up the themes of the coming revolution years ahead of its time. And I think Lanford's work does something like that for us. It's always an examination not so much of where we are now, or where we have been, but rather where we're going to be in the future.
Well, let's talk about
I think of playwrights as kind of prophets, as a matter of fact. I find their power to look into the future rather frightening.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's talk about that in relation to Mr. Wilson's current play, which is now playing at the Circle Repertory Company on Sheridan Square, the 5th of July. By the way, for those of our viewers who have not yet seen the play, I can recommend it highly. Just let me give you a few of the marvelous critical notices that have been written about it. Rex Reed in the Daily News called it one of the most incredibly well-written, beautifully acted, profound and moving and hilarious plays he's ever seen. He says it's simply the best play in town. Pia Lindstrom of ABC calls it a sparkler, delightful. Douglas Watt, stunning performances. John Simon, witty, wistful, and exquisite. The Q Magazine, vastly enjoyable, and so on. What is the theme of the 5th of July? What are some of the things that the playwright is dealing with in this particular play?
The play really looks at, it's a fascinating play because it's so very close to a subject that I think a lot of people are very concerned about. We find ourselves now not just in the 70s, but really at the end of the 70s. The 80s are on our doorstep. And The 70s have been oddly uneventful in a certain kind of sense, certainly compared to the tremendous activity that occurred at the end of the 60s. And so, in a way, Lanford is looking back to the tremendous activism, anti-war, the drug culture, all of that, that really blossomed in the late 60s, and it took us through the Vietnam War and dumped us now on the doorstep of the 80s with saying, you know, where do we go from here? Mm-hmm. But I believe that the play is much more timeless than such a description might indicate, in the same way that I think the Three Sisters is still a timeless play, despite the fact the Russian Revolution has happened. A lot of people, by the way, the reviewers all compared it a tremendous amount to Chekhov, which was very funny from the point of view that when we began work on the play and throughout the rehearsal period, Chekhov was never a conscious thing on our minds. We thought we were doing something more along the lines of "You Can't Take It With You." It's really quite a funny play, and I think, in a way, none of the reviews quite described the tone or tenor of the play, which is a riotous comedy. And the tone is quite raucous and rowdy and not as gentle as I think the Chekhovian implication makes it sound. So we were very surprised at all the comparisons to Chekhov. Looking back on it, I can see how they felt that. I believe that it's in the very best sense. It's not Chekhovian in the sense of being a model or a, you know, not at all. I think it's much closer, in fact, to 30s madcap comedy.
Right. Now the play takes place on a farm in a rather small, remote, rustic kind of
Near Missouri, in Missouri. Near Lebanon, Missouri. The situation in the play is that our hero is Ken Talley, who is in his mid-30s now, and he is a recent victim of the Vietnam War. I mean, by recent, about I guess we're playing about 1971. He lost both legs above the knee, and so he now has prosthetic devices and walks on crutches and everything. And it involves the visit of some of his old cronies from the late 60s, Gwen, who is a copper heiress, and John, who is a kind of focal point in the play between Ken and Gwen and Ken's sister June. There's a homosexual relationship or a long time love affair that has gone on for a great period of time behind the play. And in the present, Ken is now living as a double amputee with his lover, Jed, who is the new kid in town, or in the country, and he is trying to build an English garden. So in a way, it's about the invasion of these past relationships coming, bursting into his present very settled kind of existence in the country.
I don't want to blow this out of proportion, but I would like you to talk a little bit about the way Lanford Wilson deals with this particular homosexual relationship. I found it very unusual and very refreshing treatment of a homosexual lover situation in the theater. I've never seen anything quite like it. What in your mind makes it rather different than anything you've ever seen before?
This came about a few years ago. As a matter of fact, I suggested to Lanford that I was so sick of seeing homosexuals depicted the way they are in most of contemporary drama. There's always either it's a very dated view, such as I feel The Boys in the Band is at this point, certainly in terms of liberation or consciousness, and at the same time, either it's presented as sick, or it's the main focus somehow. This is the big drama in people's lives.
There's an impassioned plea for understanding.
Exactly. And so I suggested to Lanford some time ago. I said, would you please write an honest, simple homosexual relationship that's really the way the relationships that I know of are. And in which it's not the central focus, and that's exactly what he's done. These two lovers are certainly experiencing the kind of problems that any normal group, two people, no matter what their sexual preference, might experience. But it's not the focal point of the play. They are very much in love with each other, and I don't think that's ever really in question. No. The question is more one of the need for independence, the need to prove that he is as capable of moving about and running as fast as circles as he did before.
I thought it was quite marvelous that this relationship, these two homosexual lovers are living in a farmhouse outside Lebanon, Missouri, and they're living in a house with people who are basically heterosexual, older generation, the younger generation, neighbors and so forth, and no mention is made of the fact that they are gay. They're just simply accepted as members of that household and members of the community. No federal case is made out of it. There's hardly any reference made to it. It's just there. And I thought that was something that strikes me. That's something I've never seen before.
And I think also in terms of approaching it, we haven't done anything about underlining the homosexuality. There's a very beautiful moment early on. I have to tell you, we had Rutgers College brought out the first three previews of the play. And when we began the first night, there was a John, who is the old friend, there's no homosexual relationship there at all, but he's just an old friend, came in at the very beginning of the play, and he walks over and hugs Kent. And immediately the college students all kind of went, oh, like this. And I thought, well, you know, just wait, because within the first 2 minutes after John is already off stage, on comes Jed, who's played by Jeff Daniels, the real lover. And he comes in, takes off his shirt, walks over and kisses him full on the lips, and goes right about his business of, you know, as though, you know, this is everyday life. This is the way it is. And so, you know, the kids thought they were in for something sensational, and suddenly they were way out really just seeing the way people really relate to each other.
Would it be possible to say very briefly, I know this is a huge question, what direction would you like to see, or do you think the treatment of homosexuality should take in the future in the theater? Do you see any trends, any directions that you think it should take?
Well, I think to begin to see people relating to each other as people is somehow the really important thing in my understanding of it, rather than seeing it as some kind of problem that has to be solved or that has to be deeply understood or whatever. It seems to me by now we really ought to be beyond that, and I believe the liberation that people have experienced, a great many people, I've certainly experienced it in my own life, it's time to see that reflected in major ways, not just on stage, but also in films. I'm thinking of, what was the film that Paul Newman was going to do?
Front Runner.
Yeah, and if they're not going to be able to do that film honestly, then I think they ought not to do it at all, because I think it will, otherwise, if they're going to back away from it and have somebody commit suicide or something, it will underline the old conventional and I think very wrong stereotypes about the homosexual.
Right. What's in the future, briefly, for the Circle and for Marshall Mason?
Oh, well, we're running the 5th of July on our somewhat excellent notices through September 3rd. And then we will be going into rehearsal on two plays that will open the fall season. We're going to do Hamlet and Schiller's Mary Stuart in repertory. And Edith Oliver, who is a critic for the New Yorker, is constantly complaining that, well, they're accompanying all right, but they're not really repertory. We were repertory the first 2 years, and then it became impractical. And so this is very exciting to, I think, all of us at Circle, because we're going to be able now to return to actually doing two plays in repertory. And we won't play the whole season in repertory, but we're going to begin with it that way. And I'm very excited about it. I was just in Germany for 3 weeks in March, and I think the opportunity to think on a grand scale in terms of Shakespeare and in terms of Schiller is something that I could attribute to being able to see a theater that was relatively free of economic pressures. And it's really for a company. We've been working all year at Circle on Shakespeare with the Chuck Jones, who is a wonderful vocal coach. We've been doing rhetoric and all of that. And I think we're going to be ready to do some really interesting work in the Elizabethan period.
Well, thank you, Marshall. We'll be looking forward to seeing Hamlet in repertory with Mary Stuart next season. We've been talking with Marshall Mason, the artistic director of the Circle Repertory Company. Be sure to see the 5th of July, now playing on Sheridan Square at the Circle Repertory Company Playhouse. This is Ken Kliban. Thank you for watching Emerald City.
Now is the
the time to visit the world's largest emporium of erotica. Come, experience New York's most extensive selection of adult magazines, films, and paperbacks. 250 Book Center and GNA Books. No matter what you're seeing, if it's the finest in visuals you're after, we've got it all. Two locations in Manhattan. 250 Book Center at 250 West 42nd Street. GNA Bookstore located at 251 West 42nd Street. Come on over. You never know who you might bump into.
Metrolines, 24-hour live answering service. Rates are from $5 monthly. Friendly, efficient Metrolines.
Wish you could grow flowers and vegetables like the experts? Are your flowers perfect? Do your tomatoes look like this? It takes know-how, time, and effort. Digging, fertilizing, mixing soil takes all the pleasure out of gardening. Here's the answer to successful growing without work and without fertilizing. And you don't even need a garden. Victory Garden. It's light to carry, simple to use, and takes all the guesswork out of growing. Place in position, cut open the panels, mind your fingers, add water, and your favorite seeds, seedlings, or plants. Victory Garden makes any place a place to grow. Balcony, backyard, trailer, on your boat, or even where soil is just plain poor. Victory Garden is a full 30 inches long, big enough to grow 40 pounds of tomatoes, herbs, strawberries, peppers, enough lettuce to feed a family. The nutrients for all these plants are already mixed in, enough for the whole growing season, and all you ever do is add water. Professional growers use this method for consistently good results. Now you could use it at home. Send for the Victory Garden now, and I'll send you full instructions plus 3 packs of seeds guaranteed to grow.
The Plant and Grow Victory Garden is now available at any one of the following locations: Bill's Flower Market, Amos Farm, Hunter Florist, Forever Green, and the Farm and Garden Nursery.
I still love you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Trams proudly presents
I still love you.
More of the same. Ready? Here we go.
I still love you.
There's nothing that you can do, 'cause I still love you. Now try to forget me, but I still love you. You can go away and leave me alone. Never write, never phone, but
I still love you.
Well, doesn't matter how far you go, no, 'cause I still love you.
I still love you.
Get married and have a kid, but I still love you. You know there's always some things we can't forget.
You can't forget.
And I'm gonna get to you, yeah. 'Cause I still love you.
I still love you.
Now even though I know you try to shut out the thought of me,
you shut me out.
I hope you're on the lookout.
You better look out.
'Cause someday when you're least expected, I'll be there when you're least protected. And gag you and bind you and drag you away. Then I'll have my way with you. 'Cause I still love you.
I still love you.
There's nothing you can say or do while I still love you. You wrecked my life and broke my heart in two.
You wrecked my life.
And now I gotta do the same to you. 'Cause I still love you. I still love you.
I still love you.
There is nothing that you can do. 'Cause I still love you.
I still love you.
I know there's nothing that you can do. 'Cause
I still love you. I still love you. I still do.
All right.
Thank you. together much too long to drift apart. Jonathan, you opened up and gave me all you had and let me break your heart. And nothing ever hurt so much, so you ran away. Now I don't know what love is, but I know we love a different way. Jonathan, here we are again, just like we'll always be. Hanging on and running into old cliches like come and grow with me. But I wonder if you know, you make me strong. I wonder if you'll ever know, you gave me this song. Jonathan, you're not the one who filled my heart.